For many Brits, moving to sunny Europe is a lifelong dream.
It's paradise for me, it really is.
But some are determined to turn that dream into reality.
I want to be buried in that field under the hooves of those cows.
On this series, we join these plucky expats as they begin their journeys.
It's going to be challenging, actually.
I'm a force to be reckoned with.
Running hotels and bars in Spain.
It's a nightmare. Things have gone wrong already. We haven't even opened.
Retreats and B&Bs in Bulgaria.
Look at that.
Miles away.
But will it be a walk in the park?
It's like a stay at you.
A stay at you?
Or will it be an uphill battle?
Phil had a full head of hair before we started this.
This was not part of the plan.
As they start their new lives in the sun.
It's happening now.
The dream becomes reality, really.
Coming up...
Oh, that's the electricity.
The power is a problem.
Oh.
Is that the electric again?
Yeah.
As two former fish and chip shop owners battle to turn a Spanish monastery into a top-class venue for hire.
It's a massive piece of land with a massive house in it and so many possibilities.
Expat Hayley takes the plunge with a new business in the centre of a bustling French town.
Mega excited and frightened in equal measure. It's a big adventure.
And we head to Bulgaria, where the rain threatens to stop play for a couple with dreams of opening a yoga retreat.
The weather's massively thrown us and we just can't do anything in the pouring rain.
And we don't know if we're going to make it.
Catalonia in northeastern Spain is best known for its capital, Barcelona. But away from the big city hustle and bustle, the idyllic Catalonian countryside is enough to take your breath away. Nearly 25,000 Brits now call this region home, including former city girls Julie and Julia.
Hello.
Having both moved to Barcelona with their partners 2 decades earlier, they met at a mother and baby group in the city, and the pair became instant friends, and later business partners.
We had a nanny and babysitting agency for about 3 years, and then one day we had this crazy idea that we'd open a fish and chip shop in Barcelona.
So we did.
So we did.
We went and learned how to make fish and chips properly.
And we opened a fish and chip shop, and we had that for 6 years.
After feeling fried by the fish and chip game, the girls tried their hand at several other businesses in the city. Then during a break in the Catalonian hills, they decided on a dramatic change of direction.
Basically, we love hosting people. We've always got people round, so we thought we could make a living out of it, maybe.
Was one of those ideas that just sort of snowballed a little bit out of control very quickly. You know, it's sort of something we talked about after having had a few drinks over the weekend, suddenly became a mission.
And that mission was to find a property in the countryside big enough to host large groups of guests.
We spent every weekend driving through rural Catalonia. It was rather lovely.
After viewing over 50 properties, the girls stumbled upon this 18th century former monastery in the village of Alfora, available for €495,000. With 7 bedrooms, a swimming pool, and 6 acres of land, it seemed the perfect fit for their new business.
It was kind of love at first sight, wasn't it?
Because it's massive. It's a massive piece of land with a massive house in it and so many possibilities.
Julie, who's now single, and Julia, whose husband Sean didn't fancy relocating from Barcelona...
My husband didn't want to live in the countryside, so I left him in the city.
..snapped up the historic pad with plans to revamp the accommodation and create a one-stop wedding venue, wellness retreat and bolt hole.
It's definitely a life project. I mean, it's where we believe we will all retire to.
Yeah, so... everybody keeps inviting themselves as well. Yeah. We're just going to be this big community of oldies eventually.
It's June, and Julie and Julia are beginning to think about how to make this ancient building fit for purpose.
So this is the original kitchen, which
We're currently turning into a studio.
Yeah, a little apartment, so people can rent it separately.
And as they've been exploring, they've uncovered some fascinating secrets from the past.
Mm. So, this is our famous tunnel. It's blocked up, but it actually goes 2 kilometres to the nearest village. And apparently it was used by the monks as an escape route. There's been a lot of talk about opening it up. And maybe we could put a little, you know, train down to the village and go quickly down there.
A grand house has existed on this land since the 14th century. And when the monks moved on, the monastery was renovated and used as a petting zoo and a school camp.
This was where the kids all ate.
Upstairs.
We do a lot of stair climbing.
It's hard to escape the building's holiday camp past.
We have 4 showers here and 4 toilets and a little row of sinks. So the idea eventually is that each of the rooms should have access to a bathroom, which will make it a little bit less like a hostel.
The house does have a bit of a hostel feel to it at the moment, but that's not the feel we want eventually.
And if renovating the house wasn't enough work, there are also 2 self-contained bungalows in the grounds that they plan to revamp and rent out.
So these are our 2 bungalows. Bungalow 1, which is almost finished, and bungalow 2, which is how it originally was when we moved in. So this one, all the beams were completely rotten. So basically it's a new bungalow. Apart from the roof, it's a new bungalow.
The house came with a license to sleep 21 people. But there's a lot of work to do to make it less hostely and more homely. And they also want to make these derelict bungalows livable as quickly as they can, so they can realise their dream of opening the doors and welcoming large groups of visitors to their Catalonian complex. Bulgaria, the hidden gem of Eastern Europe, has a beautiful mountainous interior and almost 400 kilometres of stunning shoreline. In recent years, the country has grown in popularity as a holiday destination. And now more and more Brits are discovering Bulgaria's charms.
Change.
Brits like Kelly and Richard from Yorkshire.
We'd never actually been on holiday to Bulgaria before, but we were looking to relocate to Europe and thought we would enjoy the wild nature here. Also, it's very good value for money. There's so much culture. And so we took a 2-week trip and we absolutely fell in love with it.
Back in the UK, both Kelly and Richard had busy corporate jobs. But by the time they hit their late 30s, they realised they needed a reset.
I was a HR business partner, fantastic salary, benefits, etc. However, it involved a lot of travel and it started to get really challenging in later years, and I suffered quite badly with depression for a number of years. I was just unhappy. I started practicing yoga as a way to help manage the depression, and the idea to relocate really grew from there, wanting a change in pace of life and just a healthier lifestyle.
Where's your stick, Ginge?
Richard was working as an apprenticeship assessor, but he was also fed up with the rat race.
Oh, thanks, Ginge. I was doing shift work. So again, like Kelly was travelling around an awful lot. It was like ships passing in the night.
Come on then, big lass. Time to go. Come on now.
Richard studied Reiki whilst Kelly trained to become a yoga teacher.
Off we go.
And they came up with a plan to open a retreat centre where Richard could use his skills as a Reiki master and Kelly could offer yoga classes. And they found their perfect property in the foothills of the Stara Planina Mountains in southeastern Bulgaria. For just €20,000, they snapped up this stunning farmhouse with a separate cottage, 2 outbuildings and an orchard.
We lived in a nice house in the UK, but compared to here, I mean, it just... Well, it doesn't. If you were to buy a property like this in the UK, you'd be looking at a couple of £1 million. We could have never afforded that in the UK.
But it was a massive renovation project.
The whole place was essentially falling down. The entire property needed completely redoing.
Major work was done on the foundations, the plumbing and the electrics. And as well as the work on the house, Kelly and Richard also built a swimming pool for guests to bathe in. But given their eco-friendly ethos, it's not exactly your everyday pool.
The natural swimming pool is completely chemical-free. It's full of nature, so we have frogs and snails and lots of other aquatic creatures. There's a swim area in the middle. It's 2 metres deep. Richard was horrified initially when I said, I want a swimming pool, but I want a natural swimming pool. He's like, OK. How on earth do we do that? But we got there in the end, and it's absolutely worth it.
It's lovely to be in there in the summer. It is. It's like getting into a warm bath.
The whole build has cost them every penny they have, but the once run-down property is now a peaceful yoga retreat, and there's no turning back for Richard and Kelly.
Neither of us want to go back to the 9-to-5 grind in the UK, and we've invested absolutely everything, financially, mentally, physically, emotionally, blood, sweat and tears, the whole job lot.
Yeah.
It's now late March, and with their busiest holiday period beginning in early May, Richard and Kelly are in for a hectic few weeks.
Busy day.
Yes, love.
The property can sleep up to 11 guests, with rooms in the main house, a self-contained cottage, and, for glamping in the summer season, two currently stored away 5-metre bell tents that sit on wooden platforms in the orchard. But some prep work is needed first.
All the decks need completely restaining, so that's something that we need to get done before we put the tents up.
Meanwhile, Kelly is keen to finish the work on a new outdoor space for her yoga guests.
We're just heading up to the oldest tree on the land. We call him Granddaddy Apple. He's beautiful when he's in bloom. So we wanted to create a new meditation area, and because the energy is really strong in the centre of the land here, this is where we decided to do it.
Kelly's using old tyres as planters to create an enclosed space, along with wattle fencing made with branches pruned from the orchard.
It's a really good feeling being able to use materials that are free.
With bell tents to erect and the meditation area to finish, there's still a lot of work to do before Kelly and Richard can start welcoming visitors once again.
Now we will have 4 to 6 weeks before the season properly starts.
Yes, so we can just hope that every day is like today.
The Vienne is France's agricultural heartland. Located in the southwest of the country and home to roughly 500,000 people, it's a region dotted with small villages surrounded by acres of flat, fertile land, as far as the eye can see. And one of the most charming outposts in the Vienne is Civray. Situated on the banks of the Charente River, Civray is a picturesque market town, attracting artisan producers from far and wide who congregate twice a week to sell their wares.
Ah, bon. Merci, madame.
And is where Hayley and her husband David want to set up home.
I love this place. It's green and you've got the sea and you've got the mountains and it's just got everything here. I love it and it's where I want to be.
So taken with Civray is Hayley that she's decided to take a giant leap into the unknown and start a new business venture. She's taken over the lease of a former estate agent's office in the centre of town to fulfil her long-held dream.
The business plan is to open a salon de thé, which basically is a coffee shop, cafe, to provide breakfast and lunch in the area because there are people who would like a sandwich and have a coffee and somewhere to sit, and there isn't that opportunity here. So I saw that opportunity.
Hayley spotted a little niche market there. We're going to dip our toes in and just see how we get on.
And, you know, I'll be the first woman, female British lady opening a business in Civray, and I'm quite proud of that fact.
It's now the beginning of August, and with the one-year lease agreed and the paperwork completed, Hayley can now get cracking on creating her coffee shop.
Today, we're going to start some of the renovations. Now I've got the keys to the shop and put in a kitchen because we don't have one, so we're starting from scratch. Mega excited and frightened in equal measure. It's a big adventure. This is it. And we need to remove this partition and it'll open up the space for about 9 tables and chairs. So it's going to have complete transformation. We have to imagine that this is going to be the counter. I'll be serving different coffees, lattes. Never heard of around here, lattes. We have a very small bathroom, toilet area. And this is where the magic will happen. This is the kitchen. It's very bijou, but I'm used to tiny little kitchens. We have to actually make this into a kitchen. It's nothing but a room, really. So the sink's going to go there, dishwasher, other bits and pieces. Still to be bought because I've run out of money at the moment, so I'm just running on air, and that's it. The money that we're using, some of it's on my credit card.
With finances tight, Hayley needs to turn this space around quickly, and she has a clear time frame in mind.
In 8 weeks' time, I hope to be serving somebody their first cup of coffee and piece of cake that I've made.
It's a potentially life-changing adventure, but the pressure to succeed is huge.
My reputation is on the line. You know, I'm putting my money and also my reputation as a chef, as a cook. And in this life, you just have to hope that it works. Who dares wins.
Coming up, words of caution for Julie and Julia.
The actual ownership and running of a place like this is massive. It's a very, very steep learning curve, and I think it's dawning on them.
And Hayley reveals her plans.
This is going to be my new cafe.
No.
Oh, yes.
To her friends in France.
This has been my dream.
Wow, great.
She surprised us a lot of times.
This is the biggest one.
Yeah, this is the biggest one. Yeah.
In Catalonia, city girls Julie and Julia are embracing rural life at their country pad.
This is a pomegranate tree.
They're keen to be self-sufficient, so today they're checking on their gardens.
So this is our vegetable garden that we dug a few months ago, and it's absolutely blown my mind that we've grown everything from seed and that they've not only survived, but we've actually got proper beans, Julia, we could eat.
Oh my gosh, there's loads on this.
So we've got beans.
We've got vegetables.
So yeah, we're going to be eating our own beans tonight.
Meanwhile, they're also turning their attention to the two rustic bungalows within their grounds. The first bungalow has had all the rotten beans replaced and is in the middle of a complete internal makeover.
We've had a lot of help from friends in getting the bungalows ready. We actually, we'd still be at stage one if they hadn't helped us because...
Or we'd have had to pay an enormous amount of money to somebody to do it. We're very lucky we've got friends who are helping.
With only a few finishing touches left to do, the first of the bungalows is nearly ready to move into. So while the boys finish the exterior cladding, the girls are doing a spot of plumbing.
So my task is fitting the new toilet seat. But I have to say, I'm more of an outside doing the garden kind of person than the inside DIY bits.
And getting this throne fit for purpose...
Oh, this looks way too complicated.
..could be easier said than done.
I chose the easy job.
Meanwhile, Peter and Mark have moved on from woodwork to groundwork.
He's actually digging out. Put a barrier between the hut and the grass to stop any weeds and plants growing up underneath the wooden structure, and it stops encouraging bugs going in as well.
Once the chalets are up and running, Julie and Julia will juggle running them alongside the main house. And expat Mark thinks the girls have their hands full, keeping all of the plates spinning.
They've had businesses before, but they've never had this sort of thing before. And it's a very, very steep learning curve. And the actual ownership and running of a place like this is massive. I've got a small olive farm finca, and it's just incredibly hard work. This is on a slightly different scale. Customer service, as well as catering, for all their own land and gardens. It's a lot of work. And I think it's dawning on them.
But Julia is undaunted by the challenge ahead of them.
For me, the point of moving here was that it was going to be challenging, because I don't like staying still. So this is all new. We're city girls learning.
And I'm learning that the screw doesn't necessarily reach where it needs to reach.
Self-confessed DIY rookie Julie is struggling with the seat, so a changeover is required.
Guess maybe I'm not that good at DIY. I'm better in the garden, pulling at weeds.
But thankfully, Julia has more success.
Ta-da! Look at that, that's beautiful.
With the first chalet almost finished...
I probably should have started with the one
on the
outside.
Yeah, I know.
Julie and Julia are well on their way to being able to rent it out. And money coming back into the coffers instead of going out will be a welcome relief.
We need to earn the money back that it's cost us to do them up.
Over in southwest France, David started working on turning the former estate agent's office into a coffee shop. Whilst Hayley has moved full-time to France, David's kept a UK base and travels back and forth between the UK and France. And Hayley's going to keep him busy whilst he's here.
David's out here for a couple of weeks to help me out with all the DIY work. And because of Brexit, he can only stay here for 2 weeks at a time due to the 90-180-day rule. So really lucky to have him here to help me out, because he's going to do all my DIY for me.
Hayley heads down to the shop to check out David's plumbing progress.
Hi.
Yeah, you all right?
Yeah. Oh, that's better. A bit more room in the bathroom now.
Yeah, unfortunately, I have to take the sink out, and we've got all the waste pipes will come through here. Pipe there for your dishwasher, and then we'll have an up pipe there for the other sink.
Brilliant job. Well done. You've done that all in one day. That's not bad.
It's not bad. Good progress so far. But tomorrow we'll get the plumbing in, and then I can start hooking up your sink and the dishwasher. Oh. And as soon as that's done...
Thank you.
That's the bulk of my bit over and done with.
Oh, we should celebrate.
I think we should. Let's have a drink.
Let's whip this little baby's head. Cheers, darling.
You're welcome. Here's love. Here's the success of your new venture.
Woohoo. It's really important having David here, because he is the plumber of the family and does the electrics, and he's the muscle. And I want to do anything to keep him here.
A couple of days later, work on the coffee shop is put on pause, for a day at least, as there are some important visitors in town. And they're in for a surprise.
Today, our lovely friends Arnold and Petra have come to visit, and they don't know what's happening. They don't know about my coffee shop, and I'm going to reveal it to them today.
Arnold and Petra have made a 13-hour car journey from northern Holland.
There they are.
And they haven't seen Hayley and David for 2 years.
Gorgeous as ever.
Hello, darling.
Hi.
Nice to see you.
After a couple of glasses of fizz...
Lovely to see you all.
Yeah. Nice to see you again. Cheers.
And some steak du jour...
Bon appétit.
Yeah, bon appétit.
It's time to reveal the new business venture to Petra and Arnold.
I hope you enjoyed your lunch.
Can I sit there?
I've got a great surprise for you.
Okay, let's see.
Yes.
You have to show us. Working.
Surprise.
This is yours.
This is mine. Yeah. This is going to be my new cafe.
No.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Really?
Yeah. It's going to be a cafe, a salon de thé, doing teas, coffees, ice cream.
comes.
Oh, that's just a
little... Oh, thank you.
Oh.
This has been my dream.
Great, and now it's happening.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. Really good.
Really exciting. Yeah, new beginning.
Yeah.
Wow, great. I was very surprised she told us this. And I'm so happy for her, really.
She surprised us a lot of times.
Yeah.
But this time...
This is the biggest one.
Yeah, this is the biggest one, yeah.
I couldn't imagine.
Yeah, well, the spot is, I think, very good on the corner, near the market. So the place is good, yeah.
And I'm sure she will make her own palace of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
When embarking on a new venture, it's great to have the support of family and friends. And it's made Hayley and David even more excited for their future.
I was so excited to show Arnold and Petra all about what we're going to do. And I know that they are surprised, but they actually saw what I saw and thought it was a great location. I think they'll be back for sure.
Yeah, definitely be back for sure, yeah. And definitely free coffee next
time. Oh, yeah.
Coming up, being finished in time for the start of the tourist season could be just a pipe dream for Richard and Kelly.
Unfortunately, I haven't quite got enough pipe. I'm maybe 2 metres, 3 metres short of pipe to get to where I need to be.
We are on a bit of a time crunch and we don't know if we're going to make it.
And David has a smashing time in France as Hayley's coffee shop takes shape.
This is the point Hayley comes up and says, I've changed my mind, I would like to keep the partition.
Bulgaria, Yorkshire couple Kelly and Richard are preparing for the new tourist season. With an eye to expanding their business, they've completed work on the access road and extended the property's car park. And they've also erected a polytunnel that will allow them to grow more organic fruit and veg.
Any way we can maximise the potential of the beautiful land we've got, we want to do. We want to work with the land and make the absolute most of it and share that with our guests as well.
It's now late April, and with the tourist season beginning on the 1st of May and guests already booked in for yoga courses, there's still lots to do. And today, Kelly and Richard are focusing on the most popular accommodation on the site, the 2 5-metre bell tents, which are taken down at the end of every season. They need to go up again, and quickly, but first Richard needs to sort out the plumbing to their ensuite bathrooms.
So, the problem that we've currently got, the pipework, the original pipework that I put in, which was a kind of a temporary thing, is gone, it's warped, so this is all getting replaced.
Around 400 feet of new pipe has to be laid underground, a job that would take a week to do by hand. But that's a week Richard doesn't have to spare.
So I've got a nice little mini digger. His job's to dig, my job's just to lay the pipe. I get the easy bit. Just needed to take a couple of branches off this tree so Paul can get through and not destroy his digger.
Stand up.
The new piping will improve water pressure to the showers, and it's vital to get it installed before the tourist season begins, in less than 2 weeks' time.
Unfortunately, I haven't quite got enough pipe. I did a rough measure by pacing out, so I'm maybe 2 metres, 3 metres short of pipe to get to where I need to be, but the most important thing is that everything's underground that needs to be underground.
And then Mother Nature decides to derail things even more. After a stretch of sunny days, a change in the weather now threatens to rain on Richard and Kelly's parade.
The weather's massively thrown us because all our work is out exterior and we just can't do anything in the pouring rain.
We are on a bit of a time crunch and we don't know if we're going to make it.
The priority now is getting the bell tents up before the season starts in little over a week. But the wet weather has caused a major problem to the decking where they sit.
We need to get these decks stained before we can put the tents out. But essentially, as you can see, we've got quite a bit of standing water on the decks at the moment.
So we need at least 4 days of dry weather for it to dry out, for us to stay in it before we can put the tents up and get them ready. So we're really pushing it for that 1st of May deadline. And if the weather isn't kind, we will have to delay our booking availability, which we really don't want to do.
Over in Civray, it's early August and there's a problem that needs sorting. There's no boiler and therefore no hot water in the former estate agent's office that expat Haley is converting into a coffee shop. But husband David's come up with a solution to change that.
This morning, we've got this 10-litre hot water chauffage, which I can then connect up to the sinks because there's no hot water in here at the moment. The French use these a lot. Instead of connecting up to gas with a combi boiler, they have a little electric heater. This is a small one, costs about 100 euros. Being France, they have an electric socket in the bathroom, not something we like to do in the UK, but that's very handy for me. It just actually come with a plug, and I've got the socket in here, so that'll just plug straight in there, and that will give us instant hot water for the sink that's here, and then the main sink for washing up in the kitchen area.
There is a time pressure, though, as there are limited days for David to sort everything.
I'm heading back on Friday. I'm away for 10 days. Obviously, I want everything plumbed in prior to me going.
And if that wasn't enough, Haley's dealing with another issue.
We had a problem with the contract, whereby they got the names, the first name and the second name transposed. And when she went to open her business account with the bank, they refused it. So she's gone back this morning to see the guy who owns the building and get the contract redone. And hopefully she can set up a new bank account fairly quickly, maybe this afternoon.
So David needs to crack on alone. And his next challenge is to take down a glass partition.
I need to remove this wee beastie here, and then that'll open the whole shop up. There you go.
David wants to remove the glass panels without breaking them. But they're heavy and he needs some help.
This will be a two-man job then, because I need somebody the other side who's going to push, and then I can catch it to drop down, so I'm going to give Haley a bell. Hello, this is definitely a two-man job, so I'm afraid I can't do it unless you're here. You're going to walk down, are you? OK. Hiya.
So what have you done that needs my attention?
If you can push it through from the other side, just gently at the bottom, and then I can catch it as he comes out, and I think he's just going to just drop down.
OK.
All right. And let's see what happens. That's it. You got it. Bit more.
Wow.
Blimey. It is rather heavy. All right.
What are you going to do now? Well, you can, side?
You can let go. It's fine.
All can right? I come around and help you?
No, it's fine. There you go. All right. Go on, push. There you go. I got it. Thank you.
Oh, my God.
Thank you. Well done.
With the glass panels removed, Haley can go back to trying to sort her paperwork issue.
Today it's been a bit of a headache, a bit of a nightmare, really. There was a problem with my name on the bail, which is the lease in this country, and it's put me on the back foot because I can't open a bank account without it. And I also can't go to the wholesaler either, so, and open an account there, because I'm not a legit company. And obviously I need to be a legit company to trade.
Meanwhile, David can now carry on with the next phase of the clearance.
OK.
And he has a trusty tool to help him.
I'm going to get Old Faithful here, which has done many a demolition job for me down here, and see if I can get this lot out without bringing the walls and the ceiling down. So, let's see how we get on. This is the point Haley comes up and says, I've changed my mind. I would like to keep the partition.
After a couple of minutes of bashing, It's job done.
That's it. All done. All we've got to do now is clear up. We've had a productive day. Managed to get the whole partition down. Hayley should be, she should be pleased with what I've done. She can crack on, get it starting to look like it should do, which is going to be a pretty nice coffee shop.
Now the shop needs to be completely repainted, the new signage needs to go up, and the coffee machines need to be installed. But Hayley's coffee shop dream is edging closer to becoming a reality. Coming up, a lunchtime feast.
The spinach ones are just falling to bits.
Becomes a fiasco.
It's rubbish.
It's rubbish, actually.
For Julie and Julia.
It's me like, oh, we're just doing a really easy lunch. Won't be difficult at all. I'm having a stressful croquetta moment.
And a bell tent refuses to play ball in Bulgaria.
So now we need to undo them all again.
Again. And move it this way.
In Bulgaria, it's Kelly and Richard's last prep day before the tourist high season begins. And after a long run of unseasonal rain, the sun is finally shining once again.
We're over the moon to see the sun at last because April is normally quite warm and dry here, but this year it's been cold and wet, so we haven't been able to make as much progress. So that has been a real nightmare, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been a struggle and pretty frustrating.
The recent upturn in the weather has allowed Richard and Kelly to stain both bell tent platforms. They managed to get one of the tents up yesterday, but the pressure is on to get the second one ready today.
We'll screw it down in rough and then get the pole in and we can go from there.
We don't have any bookings as yet for the tents, but because they are available from tomorrow, we just don't want to take that risk.
Yeah, no, we would have preferred to have had it done a lot sooner than this, but it makes life all that much more fun.
The tent should fit perfectly on the decking, but finding the right spot is easier said than done.
Too close, it's too close.
So the whole thing needs to move.
Oh, damn it.
Phase two of Operation Bell Tent begins.
So we need to just move the whole tent over to the right by a couple of inches, and then we should be all right. We need to move it over a little bit more on this right-hand side, but we're almost there.
That's it.
Yeah. Good. Oh, yeah, that were easier than that.
The tent's in place. Now the front porch just needs to go on. But there's a problem.
The door's in the wrong place.
Phase three of Operation Bell Tent.
Let's give it a whirl, then. Best laid plans and all that.
I know. Oh, this tent will be easy. You know what we're doing now, no problem.
But even after three attempts, the tent is still in the wrong spot, as the walkway at the back is now too narrow.
So now we need to undo them all again.
Again. And move it this way.
It's proving to be a little more challenging than we thought, but I am absolutely determined to get these tents done today.
I'll take this centre pole out.
Yeah, you do that.
I will.
It's turned out to be a marathon, not a sprint. But after four attempts, the tent is finally in the right position.
That'll do us. That will do us.
And Kelly and Richard can finally get on with the finishing touches.
It's almost like we've staged this. And you see this kind of stuff on TV where people have just, and it's like, oh, we're just gonna, it's like, ah, that's rubbish. They're saying this for the camera. No, this is actually genuinely true. It is the 29th of April, and we are just at, well, 30th. It is the 30th of April, and we are just ready. And we are ready for the 1st of May.
In Catalonia, it's late July. One of the bungalows is now fully revamped and ready for guests. And even though there's plenty of work to do before the main house is ready, Julie and Julia want to practice their hospitality skills.
Everyone's had a little look round. I think some people are already down by the pool.
The girls currently have no plans to offer catering, but they need to check the kitchen is in working order. So they're throwing a birthday bash for Julie's daughter, Ella, complete with tapas and cava.
Croquetas, especially for Ella. It's her 25th birthday, so she gets the big celebration today.
She gets to try out the house.
Really excited. Everyone's arrived, the family have arrived. My dad just got here from England. My best friend just got here from England. So, yeah, super exciting.
Having hosted school camps, the house is licensed to sleep up to 21 guests, and many of those beds are occupied this weekend.
Everyone knows where they're sleeping. There was more debate of who was going where and a slight change around of bed.
And, yeah, all good, I think.
But Julie may have spoken too soon.
Oh, that was the electricity.
Yeah. We have a certain level of electricity, and when everything's on, especially that oven, sometimes it just goes off. Just to make it all a bit more complicated while we're doing it.
No, that actually flipped.
Julie is also missing one kitchen essential.
It's not going so well with the croquettas. So these are usually deep fried, but we don't have a fryer, which is a bit sad for two people who owned a fish and chip shop. The spinach ones are just falling to bits. Gives me like, oh, we're just doing a really easy lunch. Won't be difficult at all. I'm having a stressful croquetta moment.
And the croquettas aren't the only thing crumbling under the pressure of catering for such a large group.
Is that the electric again?
Yeah. No, it's not going to
okay,
work.
It's just going to have to be... Maybe put it in the oven.
Just put it in the oven.
But the ladies think one of their own appliances could be the culprit.
It's definitely the toaster. We bought a really cheap toaster before Christmas, and it seems that it's a bit temperamental.
It's rubbish.
It's rubbish, actually. So we just need to buy a new toaster.
Power problems and dodgy appliances aside...
They look so unappetising.
Sure, they taste great, though.
Lunch is served on time, and the behind-the-scenes drama goes unnoticed.
Cheers. Welcome, everyone.
Cheers.
Thank you for coming.
Thank
Happy
you
birthday.
Salut.
Salut. Salut.
Julie and Julia's families are staying in the main house. But the first of their two holiday bungalows is now finished, and they're keen to show it off.
So this is the orange bungalow.
It became orange because it was very 60s, 70s, so we've kind of matched it all.
Are we done with it?
And put orange everywhere.
Fabulous.
So there'll be bunk beds and a single, and then in that room there's a double.
Very retro. I mean, we heard all about it, but now we're here, it's literally... Yeah. Five times better and bigger than we ever expected.
It's brilliant. It's just gorgeous.
The positive feedback and everyone enjoying themselves has whetted the host's appetite for the future.
We'd love to do events.
Yeah.
It's what we do best. It's what we like to do. We love hosting people. We love having people here. We love seeing people enjoy themselves.
Just seeing people having fun.
Yeah, in our space.
The guest house test run has been a huge success. And with the first of their bungalows also now available to rent, Julie and Julia are all set to open for business.
The day so far has gone superbly, and I'm sure we'll carry on going superbly into the night. Everyone's having a lovely time.
Next time, a national holiday in Bulgaria puts paid to a tranquil meditation session.
The waterfall is ridiculously busy. It's never, ever been this busy before, so it's a little bit disruptive.
Julie and Julia's holiday chalet gets its first paying customers.
We've been working on this bungalow the best part of 6 months, so it's a pretty big moment.
And temperatures soar at Hayley's coffee shop painting party.
How are you doing? Not too hot.
You had picked the hottest day so far, didn't you?
I know, I'm really sorry.